3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock. 9, 10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, rock. We're gonna rock.
Like most kids that grew up in the Valley, I had a strong interest in cruising. When I got to college, and I actually studied a lot of anthropology, I began to realize that that was a uniquely American mating ritual involving automobiles. I came up with the idea of doing the movie. It was in the 60s. It was, you know, the hippie culture, drugs, cruising was gone. And I really felt compelled to sort of document the whole experience of cruising and what my generation used as a way of meeting girls and what we did in our spare time. When I grew up, I did a lot of cruising, and I grew up working in a foreign car service. I wanted to be a race driver, and I was a mechanic through most of high school. So to me, cars were my life, and that's what I thought I was gonna end up doing, was being a mechanic and racing cars the rest of my life. So the cars were very central to me in the movie, and the relationship that the people had with the cars. And it sort of got into an area that I was very interested in, still am, in terms of man's relationship to machines. I was very interested in the relationship between teenagers and rock and roll. I grew up on rock and roll, and I saw a great shift in rock and roll in the early 60s when the British invasion came, and the old innocent rock and roll, you know, came out of the blues, was kind of being distilled and moved into different directions.
I don't like that surfing shit. Rock and roll has been going downhill ever since Buddy Holly died.
When I was in junior college, I was more like, you know, John Milner, and I was more, you know, I had a race car until I almost got killed in it. So that part of the relationship between racing and, you know, always on the edge of getting killed and that sort of thing was where that character came from. I had other friends that were sort of hot dog racers that I knew, that I hung out with. And it was based on a lot of different composites of friends.
Expecting some action?
Yeah, I think so.
Paul Amat was one of the ones I thought of when I first read the script. He was a boxer, but he was also getting his feet wet as an actor and going on interviews. And I had interviewed him a few times.
And he said, I got an interview for you, and went upstairs, and there was this quiet, kind of unassuming guy sitting behind his desk, and they said, well, this is George, he's making this movie, and it's about hot rods and things, and there's a role for you in it as this main hot rodder. And I said, well, great.
He shot, I know, those moving car scenes with double cameras, so that really, when the actors in American Graffiti are in two parallel cars talking to each other, in fact, the camera was between them, two cameras sticking out of two windows, actually photographing the two sides of the conversation at the same time. And that was an innovation George came up with just to basically get more done each night.
I thought I would ride it in, bump up over a curb, put the thing into like third, and let the clutch out so it would jerk. And I thought that would be funny. I got ready. They stopped traffic on Van Ness in San Francisco because it was right in the middle of downtown. There's a big crane and everything. It was this huge deal. So I came in. I finally got the Vespa and came around, bumped up over the curb. It wasn't really all that good a bump. I wasn't that happy with it. And I couldn't get it into third. So I just left it in first and let the clutch out, hoping it would stall. But instead, it took off. So this thing scoots forward this way with me still hanging on to it, bangs into a trash thing that was there, and then finally stalls and dies. And if you look at the movie, I stand there for a minute thinking somebody's going to say cut, right? Because this was a mistake. This wasn't supposed to happen. And I'm waiting. I don't hear George saying cut. So I figure, you know, good theater-trained actor, keep acting. So I saw Ronnie, and I walked over to him. We started playing the thing.
The scene where we put the shaving cream on the car was fun because George just let us do whatever we wanted. And I remember jumping up on the car and jumping off on the other side and jumping up on another part, and the people inside were screaming, and it sort of grew. And after a couple of takes I was doing that, George took me aside and said, you know, Paul, can you try to be a little easy on the car? You know, that's not our car. The girl owns the car is in there, and she hasn't said anything yet, but you know, you're marking up the car with your boots. And I said, oh, I didn't realize that it, I thought it was a prop or something. I don't know, it was somebody's car.
Hey,
Well, I was nervous because the guy who owned it was so nervous, and he was never more than a few feet away, and but he didn't realize I was a really good driver because I had a Volkswagen VW that I, you know, with stick shift, so I really understood how to drive, and this was automatic, and it was like no problem for me. But the guy was always polishing and be careful, don't touch this and don't touch that, and don't get too close to the curb, and don't watch out for the white wall, and don't do. All right, all right.
The whole cast was required to be on location for the entire period of the shoot, which left the people who weren't working any particular night hanging around the hotel at night with very little to do.
The crash at the end of the movie, we'd used a car from that had been in two-lane blacktop, and it had been all sort of fixed up, and it had all kinds of anti-roll bars and been lowered and everything, and it was really hard to roll it.
And we always had to shoot it at dawn, so it was a magic hour shot, and we had only one chance, one take, each time we tried. I think the first time the car went off the road and didn't roll.
So I just took the car out and we tipped it over and I shot the scenes. And we tipped over we had a second car that was all gutted and we blew it up, and I shot the whole ending without the piece where the car actually spins and rolls. So I came back with a second stuntman about 2 weeks later and we tried to shoot it again. He couldn't roll it. And then we came back again. I think we came back almost four or five times before we finally were able to roll that car. They didn't feel the story had enough, you know, Hollywood pizzazz. I mean, they wanted a murder. They wanted kids getting killed. They wanted to have it be, you know, really hyper, something that you're not really that experienced at. I mean, American Graffiti is one of the most successful investments of all time. The return on the dollar spent is, I think, greater than almost any other movie made.
Happy birthday.